And he said, what'd you do, set a land speed record? And I said, I did. So after the gumball, Alex and I, you know, remained pretty close friends, and we'd hang out in New York and spend some time in his loft and have dinner here and there, and he'd introduce me to a girlfriend of his or whatever it was at the time. And, you know, we were just in touch and kind of loosely and mostly about cars. You know, Alex at the time was bragging about his lap of Manhattan, and that was, you know, his kind of, a bit of his kind of claim to fame, and I just kind of didn't understand that and seemed like a really dangerous endeavor to embark upon. You know, one of these other times he came down, he had me come down to his apartment, he said, add something for me, and he gave me one of his Pulitzer, you know, master peloton, you know, jackets, you know, and I was like, cool leather jacket with a bunch of weird patches on it. I don't know when I'll wear this, but it's awesome. And then he brought me over to his workstation, and he started showing me some videos of him going across the country in a spreadsheet of everybody from the 70s and 80s and everybody that had logged a time on the Cannonball Run, about, you know, who the fastest time was and what car they did it and the team's names and, you know, who did all these things. And I say, where do you get all this information and why do you have this and, you know, who cares about this stuff? And then he explained to me, well, first he said, I need you to sign something. He made me sign a non-disclosure. And then started telling me about how he was attempting to break the Cannonball Run record, and that he had made one attempt, and to him that made him realize it was possible. I think he was 33 or 34 hours or something that he told me the time. I don't remember exactly what it was. And then the same guy, his good friend John Goodrich, who he had done that with, they went again, and they had a breakdown in Oklahoma. It turned out to be a clogged fuel pump and filter from years of gumball expeditions around the world using bad gas and whatever else. Apparently that was the cause of the breakdown. But John, after that point, had decided he wasn't going to go again. The other reason, which I realized quickly later, was that he wanted me to do the Cannonball Run with him. He's telling me, you know, this is a big decision. There's a lot of risk involved and it's really dangerous. And I want you to spend some time thinking about, you know, if this is something you're up for. Just go home, take a night to sleep on it, and you know, give me an answer in the next couple of days. I was like, all right, well, maybe I'll go think about this. And in the back of my head, I'm like, I'm doing this. I make it as far as his front door, and I turn around and I said, thanks for the jacket, I'm in. He goes, no, sleep on. I said, no, I'm in. That's how I kind of became the co-driver. When Alex called me into his apartment and gave me the jacket that night, I think that was sometime in the fall, probably September. And the run, as you know, was Columbus Day in October. So I had a month or so to prepare, which whatever preparation was at the time, I knew we were going for a drive for a weekend. And I was willing to take the risk. So as everybody knows, we broke the record. We broke it by over an hour. And Alex had been, you know, he had done all the math. He'd spent all his time programming and all the frequencies for the police scanners and everything else. And he was trying to explain to me how to average over 90 miles an hour, which was the threshold to break the record, you could just drive at 94 miles an hour. And over time, that would average the stops in and get you above 90. And I'm thinking in the back of my head, what about stuff you can't account for? Like bad weather or construction or a tire, don't you need to be going faster than that to account for any of these, you know, a flat tire or a, you know, broken headlight or whatever it might be? So he kept trying to tell me that, you know, his strategy was, you know, not really go that fast. I'm like, what is the point of trying to do a Cannonball Run race and moderate your speed to a point where it's... That wasn't my strategy, and I made that very clear from the beginning that we're going to go as fast as we can when we can. And I knew that was a winning strategy, and I knew that was a strategy that I was going to embark. And I constantly pushed Alex to go faster, and most of the time he listened. But yeah, we got it done. But the really interesting part for me was I could tell all kinds of stories about stuff that happened. Like one of the most dangerous things that happened the whole trip was hitting a jackrabbit in Arizona, sitting on the tarmac at 1 o'clock in the morning when you're so fatigued and, you know, your vision is starting to get blurry and you're just so tired. I'm like, I had to swerve to avoid a jackrabbit. That could have blown up the whole operation right there. But The fatigue was a big thing for us, or at least for me, when you get to that, you know, that last two thirds when it really sets in before the adrenaline of the final push to the finish, you're exhausted. It's a long time to run your body on a really high level of adrenaline before it just kind of wants to take a break. So anyway, we get to the pier in Santa Monica, which is where we finished our run, and you know, had the champagne celebration as you do, and had our friends who flew the plane, and people documenting, and other people, and reporters met us there. And it was like, all right, it's over. Kind of, then what? It's like, well, for me, it was a really strange situation because here I am. It's a bank holiday, but the markets were open, and I worked on a trading floor. So I technically had to be at work in a matter of hours. Well, that just wasn't going to happen. I was on the other coast. So I actually had to stay up. I think we got in around 2 or 3 in the morning. I had to stay up until 5 in the morning so that I could call into my boss, who would be getting in at work at around 8 o'clock in the morning, you know, 3 hours ahead of time in New York, to call in sick. And that was an interesting call. But as exhausted as I was, I knew I had to stay up another 3 hours just to call on my boss and call in sick at the time. So I get a ride from Corey, who rode in the back seat to the airport to catch, I think, like a noon flight home or something like that. And my phone rings and it's my dad. My dad says, "Where are you? I just tried you in the office." And I said, "I'm not in the office." He says, "Well, where are you?" And I said, "I'm at LAX. He's like, "The airport in California?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Well, what are you doing out there?" I said, "I just drove here." And he said, "What'd you do? Set a land speed record?" And I said, "I did." Yeah, and after that, so set a land speed record at the time. That was the record. And then, you know, we weren't supposed to tell anybody. I had to sign non-disclosure agreements because we were going to wait till the statute of limitations expired. I think it was also a function of Alex finishing his book at the time. So we waited a year before we told anybody. And that was hard to do because here you are kind of giddy that you've had this, you know, huge accomplishment and you can't tell anybody about it. So that was sort of bittersweet. And I had some of my family and some other friends and stuff who I also had signed non-disclosure agreements so that I could at least tell them a little bit. It was tough not broadcasting that to the world. And so we waited a year before we came out with the news that we had set the record. Alex had called me up one day and he said, "Did you see this?" And I said, "Did I see what?" And he sends me an article. Richard Rawlings and Dennis Collins went out and they set a record across country, 31:59, and broke the record, which Alex and I knew that it was not faster than our time, and we're thinking technically, well, they didn't set the Cannonball run record. We set it. We just didn't tell anybody about it yet. That led into all of the discussion and discrepancy about, well, you didn't start at the Red Ball Garage and you didn't finish the Portofino Inn, and you know, we had a little bit different start and finish point. And to us, it was one of those things that, well, that's negligible anyway. And that doesn't really matter because the real Cannonball run was actually started from one time in Connecticut. And I think everybody who really wants to claim that they set the record goes from the Red Bull Garage to the Portofino Inn. And we wanted to break the record by enough so that, you know, people wouldn't argue that we didn't break a record. And I wanted to break it by over an hour. I pushed Alex in the last 100 miles or so to make sure that we were going to beat it by over an hour. So when the news came out, it was, look, I wasn't in it for the fame. It was really the Alex Roy show when we told everybody, and he's the one who paid for PR people, and he's the one who went on Letterman, and he's the one who wrote a book. And for me, I was satisfied with the accomplishment of just doing it. I wanted something that nobody could take away from me, and something that we did, and I put in a really good effort and broke the law as much as I could the entire way across the country to leave a little mark on automotive history. So for me, what happened after, you know, I wasn't the headliner and newspaper articles, and I didn't organize magazine articles, but yeah, it was cool to see stuff written about you and hear your name broadcast here and there. And, you know, again, at the time I was working a job in compliance. So as much as I kind of wanted everybody to know about it, I didn't really want work to know about it. And it really never got in the way of any of my work endeavors, other than the fact that people on trading floors and whatnot thought that I was more than just the compliance guy working on the desk. Has it done anything else for me in that regard? I will say it was just kind of the beginning of, you know, other automotive pursuits. You know, at the time I was working my way up the driver education program in the Porsche Club, and later went on to become a driving instructor for the Porsche Club. And then I kind of grew out of that whole driver's ed thing and got into competitive racing. And Started in the 24 Hours of Lemons with an E30 BMW and kind of moved out of that series and got into Chump Car, which is now, I think, Champ Car, and had a lot of fun doing wheel-to-wheel racing and endurance racing and on a racetrack. I like going fast around racetracks much more than I like going fast on highways. To me, that's a lot more fun. It's a lot more skill and a better adrenaline rush, and you're not breaking the law.
We are living in some strange economic times, and Premier is here to help you use those circumstances to buy your dream car. They have a simple lease program that makes it easier than ever to buy your dream car. They do financing for vintage and exotic cars. I've used them in the past, and I absolutely love Mitch and his team over there. So be sure to contact them before you go shopping to understand and get pre-approved for whatever your buying power is. That way you can go to the dealers, go to the private sellers, and make a very qualified, but perhaps a little bit insulting offer.